God bless you. Welcome back. And remember, Jesus Christ is Lord, and Jesus Christ is come in the flesh. He did come in the flesh, fully God, fully man, 2,000 years ago. And he is still here building his kingdom in this flesh. Okay? So why do I always start my videos like this? Well, it's the 1 John 4 test. Test every spirit. And when a man speaks, he's speaking of a spirit. So I'm trying to also teach you how to be a good gatekeeper. Because unfortunately, a lot of us do have demons because we haven't been a good gatekeeper. We haven't been sober. We haven't been vigilant. And quite honestly, we're ignorant to the fact that demons could even be in us. So we're ignorant to the ways on how they can be in us. Okay, we've just been struggling through life, not accessing the full freedom that Jesus Christ paid for on the cross. Okay, so let's just jump right into it. How do you cast out a devil, right? Well, first you have to make a snake-like curve in your arm, okay? Make sure all your finger points are together, okay? And you want to make the snake to attract the other snakes, okay? Just kidding. Hopefully none of you, like, stopped and you'll never see the rest of this. That's a joke. There is no parlor trick. There is no pill for obesity. There is no quick scheme, okay? I need to teach you foundationally why demons can access you. First, we need to know this in order to get them out, right? If a lie brought in the demon, well, we need to know what the truth is to combat that lie and take away the stronghold that that demon has in your life. Okay, make sense? So I would like to tell you a story about a boy named Daniel LaRusso. He too wanted to learn how to fight, and he went up to his teacher, Mr. Miyagi, and said, "Hey, I want to learn how to fight." And what did Mr. Miyagi say? "Well, wax and wash all these cars. But I came here to fight." And then finishes the job, takes him a whole day. Tomorrow come back, paint all the fence, sand the floor, paint the house, right? All this stuff. But he didn't realize until the end that Mr. Miyagi was trying to teach him the fundamentals. So that's what I want to do with you here. And so first off, we're going to teach you about forgiveness. And if you stop my videos after forgiveness and you forgive the people and enemies in your life and you don't continue on these videos, I will consider myself to be a blessed man, okay? So there's a lot of things that I can focus on at the beginning, but I believe forgiveness, because if you don't forgive, you actually stop what Jesus Christ did on the cross, right? If you don't forgive, then you can't be forgiven. I mean, that is a heavy, heavy statement. And also unbelief, right? Jesus Christ went to his hometown. He wanted to heal them. It was in his will to heal them. But because of their lack of faith, his power was stopped. The Son of God, his power was stopped. Okay? And he just, "All right, well, I guess I'll teach you then." So, all right. So let's jump into it. Again, thanks for coming back. Thank you for this journey and trusting me to teach you this. And you won't be disappointed. God bless. Mark 18, 21 through 35. "Then came Peter to him and said, 'Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Till seven times?' Jesus said unto him, 'I say not unto thee until seven times, but until 70 times seven. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is likened unto a certain king, which would take account of his servants. And when he had begun to reckon, one was brought unto him, which owed him 10,000 talents. But for as much as he had not to pay, his Lord commanded him to be sold, and his wife and children, and all that he had, in payment to be made. The servant therefore fell down and worshipped him, saying, Lord, have patience with me, and I will pay thee all. Then the Lord of that servant was moved with compassion, and loosed him, and forgave him the debt. But the same servant went out and found one of his fellow servants, which owed him 100 pence, and he laid hands on him, and took him by the throat, saying, Pay me that thou owest. And his fellow servant fell down at his feet, and besought him, saying, Have patience with me, and I will pay thee all. And he would not, but went and cast him into prison till he should pay the debt. So when his fellow servants saw what was done, they were very sorry, and came and told unto their lord all that was done. Then his lord, after that he had called him, said unto him, O thou wicked servant, I forgave thee all that debt because thou desiredest me. Shouldest not thou also have compassion on thy fellow servant, even as I had pity on thee? And his lord was wroth, and delivered him to the tormentors till he should pay all that was due unto him. So likewise shall my heavenly Father do also unto you, if ye from your hearts forgive not every one his brother their trespasses." So a talent is a measurement of weight. So if that servant had a debt of 10,000 talents in silver, that's easily $1 million. If it was in gold, that was easily a $1 billion debt that was forgiven the servant. And then the 100 pence that his fellow servant owed him was basically roughly $20 in our time. So he couldn't forgive. He was put into debtor's prison. And that jailer acts as a tormentor, okay? So you can pray all you want against diseases and the torments that you're in currently, but it's the king who you're praying to who put you there in the first place. He's just waiting for you to forgive so you can be released. This isn't the first time the Lord has used an evil spirit, 1 Samuel 16:14, but the spirit of the Lord departed from Saul, and an evil spirit from the Lord troubled him. And again, in 2 Corinthians 2:10-11, we see a correlation between demonic attack and unforgiveness. Paul is encouraging the church in Corinth to forgive a member, lest Satan should get an advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. And finally, the last example is Ephesians 4, be angry and sin not, let not the sun go down upon your wrath, neither give place to the devil. So this is obviously geared towards Christians because we've been forgiven the $1 billion debt, and so we need to forgive those who owe us $20. And if we don't, there are warnings, and it's clearly stated that if we don't do this, then Satan can take advantage of us or oppress us or will give place to the devil in our lives. So pretty much it's pretty clear that you can have a demon, especially if God is the one handing you over to tormentors. Even in the Lord's Prayer, it's pretty basic. Lord, forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Casting out demons is actually the easy part. What the hard part is for you to forgive your betrayer or your abuser or your molester. When you forgive somebody, you're not saying what they did was right. You're not approving what they did. You're just releasing yourself from them. You're releasing yourself from the tie. And time doesn't heal all wounds. In fact, it makes it worse. And sometimes you have to also forgive the ripple effect. So if somebody steals my car, and because I don't have a car, I lose my job, well, I have to forgive them for both those things now. So I'd like to take a break. I'd like to take an intermission. And please go get a piece of paper and a pen. I challenge you to be a doer of the word and not just a hearer. Ask the Holy Spirit to reveal to you anybody that you need to forgive. And you need to add yourself. You need to forgive yourself as well. And you need to see if you need to forgive God. Not that God has sinned against you, but it still doesn't stop us from holding grudges against him, especially if we don't understand things. So I challenge you to do this. I beg you to do this. Please pause the video. I'll be here when you get back. Know ye not that ye are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you? So the temple is three parts: outer court, holy place, and holy of holies, and we're three parts. So I want to prove to you that the devil can be in the outer court or the holy place, but just not the holy of holies, which would mean you're possessed. So the outer court would represent your body, the inner court would represent your soul, mind, spirit, feelings, will, and the Holy of Holies would represent your spirit. 1 Samuel, now the sons of Eli were sons of Belial, they knew not the Lord. So a prophet Lord comes to Eli and says, and honorest thy sons above me, to make yourselves fat with the chiefest of all the offerings of Israel, my people. So these sons of Belial were taking the fat off the meat, and we're getting fat off the burnt offering. And that's obviously in the outer court. So sons of Belial were in the outer court. And Nadab and Abihu, the sons of Aaron, took either of them his censer and put fire therein and put incense thereon and offered strange fire before the Lord, which he commanded them not. And there went out fire from the Lord and devoured them, and they died before the Lord. So they offered incense in the holy place. So even though they were killed, they still were allowed to be in the holy place and do evil. Matthew 21. And Jesus went into the temple of God and cast out all of them that sold and bought in the temple, and overthrew the tables of the money changers and the seats of them that sold doves, and said unto them, it is written, my house shall be called the house of prayer, but ye have made it a den of thieves. So we all remember this, but here's a den of thieves setting up in the outer court, which Jesus Christ vehemently cast out, which I think is a great picture for us. Hereafter I will not talk much with you, for the prince of this world cometh and hath nothing in me. So another example of Jesus Christ showing that the devil has no hooks, no desires, and no demons in him. He is pure.
Mark 7. For a certain woman, whose young daughter had an unclean spirit, heard of him and came and fell at his feet. The woman was a Greek, a Syrophoenician by nation, and she besought him that he would cast forth the devil out of her daughter. But Jesus said unto her, Let the children first be filled, for it is not meet to take the children's bread and cast it unto the dogs. And she answered and said unto him, Yes, Lord, yet the dogs under the table eat of the children's crumbs. And he said unto her, For this saying, Go thy way, the devil is gone out of thy daughter.
Okay, so I have a lot of scriptures to go over, so forgive the notes, but I'll be referring to my notes a lot. So according to Jesus Christ, deliverance is the children's bread. And he did deliver the Greek woman because she, one, was humble. I mean, he basically called her a dog, and she humbled herself and fell at his feet. So Jesus Christ had mercy on her, and she had great faith. Matthew 10, when he sent out the 70, he said, Only go to the house of Israel. Do not go to the Gentiles. So again, kind of like cleaning up the church. You know, you got to clean the children's house first, and then you can go out to the world. So obviously deliverance, he empowered the 70 for deliverance and to heal the sick. Again, when he sent him out, he didn't say, you know, pray to see if I'm using this disease in their life or a lesson. He just said, heal them, and he said, deliver them. So to me, that seems like that's God's heart, God's will, is for you to be free. Luke 13, 10 through 16, Jesus made it a point that this lady found in the synagogue is a daughter of Abraham, and she was bowed down, I would assume a scoliosis, and he says Satan has bound her for 18 years. Okay, so he healed her. Satan has bound her physically for 18 years. All right, daughter of Abraham. Acts 5, Ananias and Sapphira. It doesn't come out and say that they were Christians or spirit-filled, but this is the early church, and they were selling property to and giving the funds to the church. It says Satan filled their heart, and the heart would be the holy place, right, that Satan entered. So Satan filled their heart to lie, and we know the rest of that story. They were killed for that, to lie unto the Holy Spirit. Matthew 16, 23, Jesus told Peter to get behind me, Satan. So Satan influenced Peter's mind, and Peter took the bait and spoke to Jesus to try to hinder him from going to the cross. So Jesus, you know, knew that it was Satan's words, not Peter's. Luke 22, 3, Satan entered Judas. Now, you could think Judas is a betrayer and, yeah, no big deal. But Judas walked with Jesus Christ for 3 years, the Son of God incarnate. So to think that, you know, we shouldn't be prideful, I guess I should be saying. Because me or you haven't walked with Jesus Christ for 3 years. But yeah, he obviously was deceived. So Luke 9, 54 and 56. This is when the disciples wanted to call fire down from heaven on the Samaritans. And Jesus Christ said, you don't know what spirit you speak of. You know, I came to bring life, not death. And I'm going through these scriptures kind of fast. So, you know, I expect you to do your due diligence and look them up. You know, make sure I'm not taking them out of context. Test everything, right? 2 Corinthians 12, 7, the thorn in the flesh, Paul's thorn in the flesh. The thorn is specifically told in the Bible that it's a messenger of Satan, and that's another definition of what a demon is. It also says it's in the flesh, right? So it was in his outer courts. And if you want to use this verse and saying, well, God's, you know, I have a disease because God's trying to teach me something, or, you know, when I'm weak, I'm strong. But Paul specifically says, I have this thorn in the flesh, lest I be exalted due to, lest I be exalted above measure due to the abundance of revelations. Okay, Paul, his shadow was healing people when he walked by him. His handkerchiefs were healing people. He was seeing a tremendous amount of power working through him. So specifically, we all know that Satan's number one sin is pride. And so this was God's mercy of buffering him to keep him humble. And so if that is happening to you, where your shadow is healing people and you're seeing an abundance of revelations, and then you get a demon, to buffet you, then yeah, you can correlate yourself with Paul. But until that happens, it's God's will that you are healed. Okay, and I'm going to get more into diseases and healings and being a gatekeeper in the next video. Acts 8:13-23, Simon the sorcerer, okay, it says he believed, says he was baptized. But then once he saw the disciples laying hands on people and filling them with the Holy Spirit, he wanted to give them money for that gift. And the disciples said that, I see that you're in the gall of bitterness and in the bond of iniquity. Okay, a bond is, you know, he's bound. So even though he was saved and baptized, he was still a slave to unrighteousness. So deliverance is freedom. So, you know, it doesn't specifically say it was a demon that had him in bonds, but still yet he wasn't free, even though he was baptized and saved. So the legion comes out to Jesus. We're going to get into this story a little bit more, but Jesus sends the demons out into the pigs. Okay, so the pigs, it says they numbered in 2,000. They run off a cliff, basically, and they drown. So my question is, what happened to the demons after that? Are there demons still attached to pig bones, you know, at the bottom of the sea? Or were the demons released right away once the pigs died? So this is all speculation from now because we don't know the answer. I would speculate that the demons were freed after the pigs died. And so then I'm thinking, well, why wouldn't Jesus just cast them into hell or a pit where they couldn't come back from? And I'm gathering that based on Job 1 and other verses, is demons are tools. And I believe God uses demons for his tools as well. Now, bear with me. When you look at Israel in the Old Testament, I mean, the whole Old Testament basically is summed up with Israel obeying God, keeping a sharp eye on the king, not serving any other idols. Life was good. The moment they started marrying other women and the women started bringing into from other nations, started bringing in their gods, then they would start making idols and getting seduced by spirits. And then they would turn their back on the one true God. And then when that would happen, then God would send them, usually a nation, to buffet them, to say, hey, this is your discipline. You need to come back to me. And sometimes they were taken in captivity. They were slaves. I mean, look at Egypt, right? They were slaves for 400 years. And then they repent, then they humble themselves, right? And then God brings them back into their land. And that happens over and over and over and over again in the Old Testament. So why doesn't that happen with us? I think it does. I think if you turn your back on God and you start doing your own thing, and as in 1 Timothy 4:1-2 says, now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some... Sorry, I can't read my writing. Some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. And the next verse says that they have their consciences seared by a hot iron. So I believe that happens today. And I'll get into the next video on how to be a good gatekeeper, but sin and other things, you open yourselves up to the enemy. And it's God's mercy and discipline and grace that you do get a demon. Life sucks if you turn your back on God, and it should. But the thing is that Satan has taken out this doctrine that you can have a demon and that you need to fight it and say, oh, okay, I need to repent. I need to confess what this open door was and shut the door and get back with God. But instead, Satan has the church go into psychologists or pharmacies and or alcohol or drugs to self-medicate this demon. And that's really hurt the church. So not only are we have the original demon, we are using chemical dependencies to basically self-medicate. And usually those dependencies lead to other demons. And so I just want us to come back to basics. So in Mark 16, we're given the power to cast out demons if you believe in Jesus' name. We're also given the authority to heal the sick and drink poison and you know, pick up snakes, whatever. I'm not saying we do that on purpose. So if you don't believe that Christians can have a demon, then that authority is just strictly for non-Christians in your mind. Hopefully this whole long list of scriptures and the forgiveness thing, I'm trying to sway you from that and to show you that Christians can have demons. And therefore, I can move on to what I really want to share with you is on how to get rid of those demons. If deliverance is only for non-Christians, then wouldn't that be in danger of Matthew 12, 43 through 45? And that's the scripture where the spirit goes out of a person, goes to dry and arid places, comes back, finds his house swept and garnished, goes out again, gets seven more demons, stronger and more evil than itself, and comes back. And the nature of that person is worse off than before. So why in the world would you cast a demon out of a non-Christian? They're not repentant. They're still going to be sinning. They're not wanting to be saved. So why would you? Granted, if they're coming to you and they're like, I want to be saved, you know, or even then, just save them. But even then, if you don't think that, it would be a mute point with Mark 16. Because why don't you just save them then? If the Holy Spirit goes into them and all of the demons just take off once they're saved, then giving us the authority to cast out demons is kind of a moot point, isn't it? Because why don't you just save them? The Holy Spirit goes in them, blasts out the temple, right? And no demon can enter the temple. But clearly I showed you, I'm trying to show you that demons can't enter the temple. They can't enter the Holy of Holies, right? Because only the Holy Spirit can reside in there. But I've showed you, it can enter the outer courts and they can enter the holy place. Holy place meaning your mind, your soul, your heart, your will, your emotions, your feelings, right? Depression, anxiety attacks, those are demons. And then the outer courts would be the body. So Paul's thorn in the flesh, the woman who's bowed over for 18 years. There is one place where Paul did cast a demon out of a non-Christian, and that was Acts 16, 16 through 19. But here was a female that had a divination spirit, and she was a slave. And it said they followed around Paul, and I forgot who his friend was, for days, yelling out, these guys are from the, you know, Son of God, you know, here to help you or whatever, just yelling at him for days, right? Sorry, I'm kind of butchering the scripture. You can go look it up. But it says Paul was grieved, and I did look up grieved in the Greek, and it means offended or worked up. So after days of this witch basically yelling to other people around Paul saying, hey, here's some godly guys coming to town to help you out. After days of that, it says Paul was worked up and he cast a spirit out of her. Well, the handlers knew that their money machine was done for, so they have them whipped and put in a prison. So technically, it seems like Paul was kind of cast his demon out of his flesh. But because again, you know, if she's not saved, there's nothing to replace that Holy of Holies, and that demon's just going to come back, especially if she doesn't repent. She doesn't close the door to that divination spirit in the first place. So if Paul was going to cast out demons to sorcerers, and that was his M.O., then in Acts 13:11, Paul sees Elymas, the sorcerer, and instead of Paul casting out demons, he blinded the guy. So again, the sorcerer wasn't coming to Jesus. The sorcerer wasn't repenting. The sorcerer was withstanding Paul. And so he didn't cast out his demons. He just blinded him. So anyways, these are my proofs that I believe that Christians can have demons. Hopefully, like I said, go through my references yourselves. Pray about it. Plus, the ministry that I was trained under, Don Dickerman, he's done 25,000 plus deliverances. And it is a requirement to be a Christian before you go there. Again, you cast out a demon because they don't have legal right to you. Well, if you're not a Christian, they have legal right to you. Because you're not confessing, you don't have the Holy Spirit, you don't have Jesus Christ blood working on your behalf. You don't have the power of the cross on your side. So that's good news, right? So if you're struggling with things, it could be a demon. So that should give you hope, because before you didn't even, you're just fighting it with antidepressants and anti-anxiety medication and Xanax and Ambien, and that's your only hope. And you know those side effects are hurting you more than, you know, usually the disease is. So anyways, there's freedom. And if you can't tell by my voice, during the making of this video, Satan tried to attack my voice and my throat, but I warred against it. I didn't say, oh, the weather's changing, I deserve this, or my wife, you know, brought home some germs from the hospital. I didn't say that. I prayed, Holy Spirit, is there an open door that allowed this demon to attack me? And if there was, I repented, and I warred against it. I rebuked it. So my throat feels good. I'm just kind of, I don't know, voice box is getting back in order. But I'm encouraged. I like being attacked. It shows me I'm doing something right. So it's a win-win situation, folks. If you're attacked, you get rewards in heaven. If you're not attacked, you're free to do what God wants you to do. So it's a win-win, folks. So be encouraged. And I love you. And so the next video is going to be on, since now I've hopefully persuaded you that you can have a demon. So now, obviously, the next videos are going to be on how to get rid of them. Based on being a good gatekeeper's next video, and diseases and sicknesses, and that probably will touch into generational curses. So I love you, and see you soon. Stay tuned. Subscribe if you haven't.